Hi, everyone. Professor, University of Michigan Dearborn, Aaron Kinzel. I'm glad to come out here and talk to everyone today. How many of you are actually CJ majors, or are anybody outside of the department that just is interested in criminal justice? Okay, so CJ majors. Yeah. So other side, what's some other majors that are interested in CJ? Shout them out. Don't be scared.
I'm a neuroscience major.
Very interesting, quite outside the box. Okay, how about some others?
Higher education and student affairs.
Okay, good.
Anthropology.
Psychology and political science. Okay, double major, cool. All right, well, I'm glad to have everybody out here. I don't know exactly how much Sam shared with you other than the fact the flyers probably say prison to professor, so right there, that in itself kind of gives you a little bit of a hint of what's going to my speech is going to entail. I'm actually finishing up my doctorate at the University of Michigan Dearborn right now. I'm in the Department of Education, but I teach in criminology and criminal justice studies. My research focuses predominantly on formerly incarcerated populations. I'm looking at predominantly adults that are in the system, but I think later on in my career, I probably want to extend that to juveniles as well, because I think there's a really interesting trajectory from juveniles into adulthood and how delinquency can shift into the adult correctional facilities. My big thing I want to really understand is how, like, what is the actual experience of incarceration kind of like? And what is my research methodology, something called phenomenology. It looks at lived experience and kind of focusing on that moment, not really an interpretation of what's going on, but just kind of like pulling out from a philosophical lens that lived experience. So what is it like to be incarcerated? What is it like, some previous work in phenomenology looks at, you know, like what is it like to live in a certain area, to be of a certain ethnic background? I would even consider someone that's a criminal or convict to kind of be a part of an ethnic area, because that's technically like a culture. Ethnicity is kind of like a shared culture that you would have. So I'm looking at that, but also from an education lens, how is it that people come into the system, and how do they learn? How do they develop as individuals? So I'm looking at four key components. When someone first initially enters the prison system, the first thing that they do, whether or not this is their first time in the system or not, they kind of observe the culture that's going on in a penitentiary setting. So they kind of like look at things, see how things run, and then they either adopt something of the culture or they reject it. And then the second part I'm looking at has to do with identity formation. So how does an individual in that environment, once they've studied the culture and become a part of the culture, how do they like form their identity? Then the next part would be something called oral histories, which is connected to anthropology. A lot of indigenous populations worked heavily. Their method of transmission and education is through oral histories. A lot of the Native American tribes and African tribes, lots of indigenous people, they pass down stories, okay? So how they educate their young is by the elders describing different situations, describing experiences that they've had and how they've overcome different adversities and how they have gone through different parts of life. And then the final phase I'm looking at is something where people that get all three of those I mentioned already talk about civic engagement. So there's a lot of people in the system, once they come in, they don't have access to attorneys. So there are a lot of people that go into the system are living in poverty, so they can't afford high-priced attorneys. So a lot of people end up doing legal work themselves. So myself as a kid in the system, I learned about law, public policy, and different ways to engage the prison system and the administration, how to fight things that I felt that were unjust for myself and other individuals going through the system. So I feel all four of those things in itself is a phenomenon. So like that experience, I believe, is kind of a shared experience for people that go in through the system. Some other stuff I do with my students, I feel that experiential learning is extremely important. We take a lot of trips to local county jails. We recently went to the Monroe County Jail and had a tour of that facility. Cell Block 7 Prison Museum out of Jackson, Michigan, which is an empty cell block that is still on live prison property where students or anybody actually can go in there and just walk through an empty block. You can actually go into these cells and kind of like really feel what it's like to be incarcerated. So I think that's an incredible thing for someone to go from the textbook reading about something to actually going in there and like feeling it? What is it like to be in such a really small, confined space? We also went to the Ohio State Penitentiary recently, and that was a really cool experience. How many of you have seen The Shawshank Redemption? Quite a few of you. Okay, so Shawshank Redemption was based upon the Maine State Prison, but it was down in Ohio that they filmed it. It's a really medieval complex, and they offer tours there where you can actually go through the entire facility, not just the cell block. So you can go through old administrative offices, down in solitary confinement, down in dark, you know, little pathways. It's a really interesting experience. I really want my students to become engaged citizens. I want them to go beyond the textbook. I want them to go beyond learning objectives. I want them to be prepared for their career. And I feel that a lot of people talk about the criminal justice system as a whole, that the criminal justice system is broken. Has anybody heard that before?
Yeah.
How many of you think the criminal justice system is broken? Just a couple of you? Really? Okay. Well, I would argue that the criminal justice system is not broken, actually. In fact, I feel it's doing exactly what it was designed and intended to do. And that would be predominantly to oppress certain populations, to oppress people that we kind of throw away in society. I think crime is more stemming from social economic inequalities. So I think we could control crime better by kind of dealing with the root issue, which is social economic inequality. Certainly we can't get rid of all crime altogether, but I feel that there's definitely things that we can do to be proactive, to kind of stop stuff before it kind of, where we get now, like we're in this era of mass incarceration, where we have well over 2 million people incarcerated right now. If we go back in time to the early 70s, we only had around a couple hundred thousand prisoners in local, state, and federal institutions. But then in the early 70s, we had political rhetoric, developing the war on drugs, and a more punitive policy to corrections, and now we've got a tenfold increase prison system, which is just astounding. And we're shelling out money like there's no tomorrow. Just here in the state of Michigan, how much money do you think that we spend annually on corrections budgets in the state of Michigan? Anybody have any ideas? It's a lot, right? A million, maybe? More than that? A few million? Over $1 billion. That's right. So annually, through the state legislature, through the appropriations division, on average in the most recent few fiscal years, we've been expending over $1 billion annually on corrections. Now that includes not just the state penitentiaries itself, but also community corrections. So that would include probation and parole as well. That's just a lot of money that we're shelling out to incarcerate folks. We've dropped our prison population substantially over the last 10 or 15 years. I think we're down to low 40,000s right now. At one point, we were up to 56 or 57,000, I believe, here. But still a lot of money. That's more than we spend on higher education. So public institutions like Eastern Michigan University, University of Michigan, Wayne State, et cetera, there is a budget that the legislature allocates for those higher education institutions. And what we're allocating to corrections is far higher than what we give to higher education. So basically what we're saying from a societal policy perspective is that it's more important for us to just lock folks up than it is to educate them. And I think that's part of the problem too with social inequality is that we're not creating streamlined access to education. So other work that I do in the community, is anybody familiar with the Prison Creative Arts Project? No? Oh my God, you guys live in Ipsy and you don't know about the Prison Creative Arts Project. So at U of M Ann Arbor, every year for, I believe, over 22 years now, the University of Michigan has gone into correctional facilities in the state of Michigan and also some juvenile facilities. They go in there and offer workshops, visual art, theater, and writing activities. So they go in to engage these prison populations, and what comes out is some phenomenal art. So every year there's a nationally renowned art show, for all the visual art anyway. Some of it is three-dimensional, some of it is just paintings or sketches, but some of the work is just really phenomenal. I believe mid-March the next show is coming up, so check that out if any of you are interested. It's a great way to kind of see some of the stuff where not everybody in the system is a monster. I'm not a prison abolitionist by any means. I think that there's some people we need to have incarcerated. There's some people that I feel should never come home. However, I think a majority of people probably should be given an opportunity. And I think a lot of people have redemptive qualities. So to focus on that, so I'm doing all these things now. How did I get here? So I'm interested in these populations because growing up as a kid, I was deeply immersed in delinquency and criminality. I think the first time I ever had police contact as a child was probably around the age of 5. My mother, I never knew my real father. My mother was surrounded by drug dealers frequently. Every man that she's ever had a relationship with was either a criminal or a convicted felon. So meaning criminal, meaning someone who's actively involved in criminality, convicted felon, someone that's done a stint in prison. So, and a lot of drug addicts too. So but as a little kid, I'm growing up, that's my circle. So like some of you, you grew up and some of you are here now kind of realizing that dream in college. You know, as a kid, I never had dreams about going to college or, you know, going to church on the weekends or any type of positive family-oriented stuff. My family environment was watching people commit violent acts, was watching people do drugs, was watching all kinds of crazy shit that as a child, some of the stuff I've seen, I probably won't even talk about, but it's just something that a kid should never see. So that kind of screwed me up. So as a kid, I'm 5 years old. Like I said, my first contact with police, I learned from one of my mother's boyfriends how to break into houses at 5 or 6. So he was a cat burglar. So I'm watching this grown man break into houses. And as a little kid, he's giving me a knife and teaching me how to pop a lock on a window. So like children very easily pick up on their environment. Bandura did a lot of research on social learning theory where when children are exposed and even adults are exposed to a certain type of activity, they mimic that activity. And I think anybody in this room could say that without knowing research. Just, you know, you see a family member or someone in your close circle, brother, sister, cousin, whatever, you see them do that activity as a child, very often you would mimic that. Okay, and you think that that's normal in a way. So I got involved in all this stuff as a kid. As I grew older, I think as I became more conscious of what was going on, I started to understand that what I was doing as a kid and what was going on around me was wrong, morally and ethically. And yet, I still kind of like wrapped up in it because it was like the only way I could see my mama. And she would often like disappear sometimes for days and days on end. So like I would actually put myself in dangerous or really weird situations in order to spend time with my mother. So as a kid, I just craved attention. And sometimes I would act out in ways and just try to get attention from my mother. And sometimes that was me going out and breaking stuff or stealing things as a kid. As I progressed further into school, I got a lot more aggressive and violent tendencies. School officials could not deal with me and really it was no fault of their own. They just didn't know how to deal with a kid like me that had so many behavioral problems and stuff that they just were not trained as educators to deal with. And I think going forward, like a policy change that we really need that's important for K-12 educators and maybe even higher education officials is you need to be able to have people in education trained with psychology curriculum, social work curriculum, so they're better able to understand the needs of some kids like myself that are just, I don't think I was really a bad kid, but I think I was definitely exposed to really bad situations, which helped to have me develop into some things that I really am not proud of to this day. So fast forward a little bit more. In my early teens, I started abusing drugs and drinking. For the longest time, I went without abusing substances or drinking or anything like that because I seen the people around me and how they would act, whether they were drunk, high on cocaine, whatever it is. Like the only drug that I would see that would calm people down would be marijuana. But a lot of people that I were around me at that time were doing much heavier drugs, and usually the result was an aggressive behavior, whether they were beating my ass or committing violence against people like my mother or other people in my close family circle. So I went from hating that type of behavior to finally getting to this point where, you know, I'm so fucked up, excuse my French, that I wanted to kind of like make my pain go away. So I started abusing drugs and getting drunk. And that was a weird way, again, for me to connect back to my mother. So when I kind of realized that, well, this is a way that I can be around my mama by doing drugs and being, you know, in this type of behavior, I took it to another level to where I realized that a lot of these men that my mother was with were big time drug dealers. So then around 14, 15, I realized, you know, maybe I can get more connected to my mom by being actively involved in just selling dope and selling guns. So now I'm a 15-year-old kid running the streets with a gun and just doing my thing. No one ever really told me what to do. Like, I never had limits placed on me as a kid. My mother neglected me. Like I said, she never physically abused me, but a lot of the men in her life did. But, like, most of the time, nobody cared where I was. I could disappear for days, and nobody was asking where I went. So I just started selling dope. That was my thing. And then, like, I was rewarded for that as a child. Like, now I was getting attention from my mom. I was getting attention from her boyfriends or our other family members. Like, oh, Aaron's doing that. A boy, Aaron. Sold a lot of dope today. Good job, bro. Like, as sick as that sounds, like, to me as a kid, I was, like, happy about that because I was getting that attention that I craved as a child in a really messed up way, but I was still getting what I needed. But it really went, like, a quick downward spiral. So, if, like, from 15, now I start developing what I call a God complex, in which no one ever stopped me from doing whatever it is I wanted to do, and there was no type of repercussion for any type of my behavior. I started getting aggressive with law enforcement. I think I was at a basketball game, 15. Cops came to the game because they smelled marijuana. And I assaulted two police officers at the age of 15. And they arrested me on the spot. And lucky for me, at that time, my mother was connected with drug dealers who had money and had connections to crooked attorneys who basically flipped the script and said that I was, you know, assaulted by these cops when I fought these two cops myself as a kid. They kind of roughed me up a little bit, but I kind of deserved it. The next day I got out of the Monroe County Youth Center for assaulting two police officers because they kind of flipped it around like the cops were being abusive to me. So that just encouraged me that there would be no consequences for any of my behavior. I went out on the streets, committed more violent acts, and just selling dope all the time. And then I went to, like, being really heavily addicted to drugs, smoking crack cocaine, doing LSD, all kinds of pills that I can't even make all the names of for, getting high all the time and constantly finding a way to make that next buck. So 17, 18, fast forward, I'm out of school. I dropped out when I was 16. I had enough of the high school life. I just went back and forth to sell drugs to kids on my school, and then, like, local schools, I was selling drugs all the time. So I got to a point where I started getting suicidal. Like, I was just tired of life in general. Like, I could not deal with all the trauma that was done to me, but also the trauma that I created as well, because I made rational, conscious choices of the things I did. Even though I knew things were wrong, I still did those things, kept going forward. So I got to a point where couple times, like, I drank myself out. I got alcohol poisoning once. I put a gun in my mouth a couple times, and not, like, to get attention, but, like, just really thinking about it, like, man, I just want to blow my brains out. I've just had enough. I was just so messed up, I couldn't take it. So 18, I'm finally, like, I went back and forth to all these different suicidal things, and I met this girl, and we connected. We both came from abusive homes. She was hopped up on drugs. And we got together, and I, for the first time in my life, I was like, you know what, I'm getting some attention, particularly from a young woman like that. I think that was something I really craved, not having anything from my mother. So we, like, tried to stop doing drugs together. It didn't work out the way I thought it would. I ended up kind of, like, diverting from my family, because at that time my family had gone from being really big drug dealers with big connections to, like, straight hardcore drug addicts. So at one time they were funneling drugs into an entire county. And then, like, around the age when I was 18, they started becoming hardcore drug addicts and just going out in the community and just robbing people just to support their drug habit. And so there was, like, this divergence. Like, I wanted to get away from that. So I went with my girl out east, and that's kind of, like, what kind of led me down to the prison pathway. So I go out east to the state of Maine, and there's a joke when I got to Maine that I found out later. It's come to Maine on vacation, leave on probation. And to this day, I still get a good laugh out of that. So everybody else is out in Maine on vacation trying to get, you know, some lobster and some interesting little national park at Acadia or all these beautiful mountain scenes and all that. So I'm out there, I get pulled over by the police. And my first reaction as a young man at that time is I'm on the edge. So I'm sitting in the car, traffic stop, a state trooper pulls up on the left of me, and I notice out of the corner of my right eye, there's somebody else that's plain clothes back here, and I'm just thinking at that time it's just somebody else kind of like wandering around citizen, wondering what's going on. State trooper comes up to the left, and within a couple seconds, without me even thinking, I pull a firearm out and blast off a shot towards the state trooper on my left. State trooper drops, and within a couple seconds, the guy on the right, who I thought was just some concerned citizen, turns out to be a cop. And from point-blank range, he empties a 9mm Beretta in the back of my car, shooting 15 times. Bullets were just singing through the back of the windshield, blew out the windshield, hit the gas tank. Later I found out there was bullets that went through like the driver's seat. Until this day, I don't know how the hell I'm not dead. They actually did forensic examinations on the car, and to this day, no one knows how the hell I'm still alive. The bullet that I shot went off out somewhere, and they never recovered it. So I ended up not hitting the other cop that dropped down. And all that's happening within, I think, 3 seconds. They've got the entire thing on film of the police chase, but 3 seconds, everything I just described happened in 3 seconds time. Over. So after the shooting stops, I take off, high speed chase. At that time, I'm kind of like in the Matrix. Like, that's how I would describe it. Like, everything's kind of blurry to me. I'm having trouble hearing. My ears are ringing because of the bullets flying that close, point blank range. And honestly, I'm not trying to sound tough or anything, but I was not scared at all. I was a whacked out kid. Like, I've been shot at before. I've been in situations like that, and that, like, did not scare me. My girlfriend was scared shitless. She was screaming. I couldn't hear her, but I could see her flailing and the mouth going, because I'm deaf at that time. She's freaking out. And I'm just like, wow, I'm just so stupid. I can't believe I just did that. So we take off, high-speed chase. I go about 10, 15 miles out in the backwoods of Maine. And at one point, I'm doing really dangerous maneuvers around other cars in like 25, 30 mile per hour. Little small town, I'm doing 120, 130 to get away from this cop. And eventually they put out a spike mat that I didn't even realize what was going on. A cop was in a ditch and just flung this thing out. The spikes come up, runs it over, and blew out. It didn't blow out the front tires. What it does, it inserts these little tubes in there and the tires slowly deflate. So I end up jumping a ditch, going off into the woods, and I'm very close to the border of Canada. So my girlfriend and I are running out into the woods while the police are chasing us. And at that time, I still got the gun in my pocket. I'm going through the woods, thinking I'm Rambo, like rubbing mud on me and stuff. And there's different times where I hear dogs. Later on, I found out that they had over 100 law enforcement officials searching for us in those woods on the border of Canada, which included federal officials, Canadian Mounties, and also just local police and state police that were there trying to get us. I knew they wanted me bad. My girlfriend was getting eaten up by the bugs and was really scared. So we're out in the woods all night long. The next day comes up, she finally decides that she wants to get the hell out of these woods. She thinks that everything is over, that, you know, they probably give up by now. And I'm like, there's no way they give up. Like, what happened? There's more of them out there. She ends up running out of the woods at one point on a dirt road. And I go out to get her. And then another unmarked cruiser comes up. Cop jumps out. I'm still there with a gun in my pocket. And now I've got, like, this moment of decision to make. And the decision I made was just to surrender at that time, because the cop jumped out, rolled out, pulled a shotty on me, and pointed at me from about 10, 12 feet away. So I surrendered with the gun still in my pocket. The funny thing is that when they're like handcuffing me, they never patted me down. So I've got a loaded pistol in my pocket while I'm handcuffed. And I think when I was a little bit thinner back then, I still kind of probably got my hand in the pocket. But at that point, I was like, you know what? I'm done with this. I'm not fighting anymore. Moments over. So I end up going to the county jail and sitting there, and I get charged with attempted murder of a police officer, along with 7 other felonies attached to that for passing a roadblock and all this other crazy stuff. And I'm facing life in prison. So by statute, in the state of Maine, attempted murder is punishable by up to 40 years. However, when a law enforcement official is the target or the victim, then it can become a life term. So I'm basically fighting for my life, and I don't have any money to buy an attorney. My family, who were then, you know, used to be big baller drug dealers, now they're kind of drug addicts. They don't want to give me no money to help me out with my situation. They're not even writing me or anything. So all I have left is my grandparents to help me out. They ended up getting a few thousand dollars to get me a kind of mediocre attorney who didn't do very well for me. I ended up pleading out to a few of the lesser charges. I got, I think, 3.5 years concurrent, meaning that all those terms would be, I would do those all at the same time. And then I went to trial for the attempted murder because I felt that what I did not, one, I don't feel that by statute it constituted a substantial step towards the commission of murder, and two, I really feel that I wasn't trying to kill that cop. As crazy as that act was, as stupid as I was as a kid, I think going back and people ask me all the time, well, why would you do that? And honestly, I don't really have a good answer. Other than that, like reflecting back on it now, as an adult, I kind of think like I was in this point like where I was protecting myself, I think. And I kind of feel like I was just punking that cop off. And I've done that before where I pistol whip people on drug deals or just fire off a gun at them and just scare the shit out of them. And I kind of worked. The cop went back and fell. He wasn't hit. But then I didn't know that there was another cop there that was going to try to kill me. And I, as a kid, I was just so stupid, I didn't even realize, you know, kind of have a future thought of what the consequences would be for that action. So I fought my case. In the end, I lost. So thankfully, I didn't get a life term in the penitentiary. By that time, I was 19. So this all started when I was 18. I sat in the county a year and a half. 19, I got sentenced to 19 years in prison. So that's where I started off in the penitentiary. Really long bid, and I was just like, man, I'm not doing this. I had every intention of like getting the hell out of there whenever I had the chance. In the beginning, I still had a lot of my aggressive and violent tendencies, but the great thing for me was with prisons, there's this hierarchical structure where depending on the type of crime you commit, there's a status that you come into the facility. So violence against law enforcement, murder, stuff like that, you're actually considered like more respectable. That is like considered a respectable crime and on a hierarchical status. So I was right up there. And so as a kid, I fed into that. Like, yeah, fuck these cops, blah, blah, blah. You know, I should have killed them, blah, blah. I fed into that. And what a lot of the older prisoners realize is that I'm more than just that kid that, you know, is violent and aggressive. A lot of these guys seen a little bit of brains in me. So some of these guys, I started appealing my case. A lot of these older guys that have been down 20, 30 years, they taught me how to kind of like let go of aggressive and violent tendencies in order to better myself. Because someday I would still get out. A lot of them were going to spend the rest of their lives in the system. But what they taught me is that if I feel something's wrong or unjust, I can use my brain and get a lot more done than my fist. So after my testosterone levels dropped a little bit in my mid-20s and I slowed down and learned more about the law and public policy, I started to change. And that was kind of where I started getting more, like I was talking about my research, where I was civically engaged, meaning that I would file lawsuits against the institution for unjust activities. I would help people in the institution, particularly people that had mental health issues, to file grievances or talk about their conditions of confinement or people that had medical issues that were not getting the proper treatment that they deserved. I found ways to fight the system that I felt was unjust in ways that were nonviolent. Maybe a little aggressive and passive aggressive at times, but not violent. So I started building myself, and for the first time I kind of felt like I was actually doing something positive. I wasn't taking from things in my life. I was doing what I felt was really good. And I ended up reading all like hundreds and hundreds of books on all types of different educational stuff. Towards the end of my sentence, I started getting involved in, and at that time they had a college program. In 1994, they took out all the Pell Grant funding out of all institutions, but the state of Maine was a unique program in which they had public tax dollars that went towards a majority of tuition. So if a student wanted to take a college course, most of that was funded. So I took that opportunity and took like just an intro level psychology course when I was in my mid-20s, I think 26 or something like that. And I actually enjoyed it. I think it kind of changed my life. And I got an A in the class. And to backtrack, I dropped out of high school as a kid, so I didn't have a diploma coming to the system. In the county jail, I got my GED, so that just gave me the basic credential to be able to take the college course. But like, I was like, how the hell did I do well at this? And then a lot of these older guys were like, look, you're no dummy. Aaron, you can do this. And you've got to find a way and a pathway for yourself coming out. So I started applying for FAFSA and stuff to prepare for my release. So I knew that like when I come home, my idea was that I was just going to jump into a community college. And a lot of people already had told me that by the time I get out of the system, I'm never going to get a job as a felon. So like I was already prepared. Like I've got to do something to diversify myself to make myself more appealable to employers. So almost 10 years into my bid, I got a mandatory parole. So I didn't do my entire 19 years. I did from 19 to 28. I got out. And I did what I said I was going to do, which was jump right into a community college. I started that. It was a really weird experience being locked up that many years and then like coming back into society, and there's so many different things. At that time, the new hotness was those little Motorola Razr flip phones. This was 2007. And I remember as a kid, I had a pager to do drug deals and stuff, but I never thought like texting would pop off or other stuff. So I'm playing with this damn phone, and this shit's like magic to me. I'm just like, wow, this is so awesome. But I'm thinking like, man, I could do so much dope with this. Then I'm like, no, I can't. I actually had family members at that time, as soon as I got home, try to like draw me back into criminality and try to get me hooked on dope again and shit. And it really pissed me off. Because a lot of them did not support me in the system when I was struggling. Like I said, I had grandparents that would send me money and help me out, send me books. They didn't do shit for me. But then when I come home, they knew I could sell dope and make money. So now they want to be my bestie again. And so I just kind of like put myself space between us. I didn't want to do anything with that anymore. So I'm going to community college. I got my little Motorola Razr phone. It was cool. I never thought I would like college. And what's weird about college is it's kind of like a controlled environment. I got professors telling me what to do, how to do it, and I'm like, I don't know if I like this. But I was learning something, though, too. And I decided to go into, like, business administration, so I ended up getting my associates in business. I got that in less than 2 years. But this whole time, I'm trying to get a job, still can't get a job. I'm applying hundreds of places. At that time, I'm more articulate. I can talk to people. I have this mentality and this good work ethic. I'm ready to work. Nobody give me an opportunity, because every time I check that damn box, since I'm a convicted felon, I never get a shot. So I'm like, all right, well, I'll really prove myself. I'll get my bachelor's degree. So I go and get my bachelor's degree. I get that a year later. So now I have an associate and a bachelor's in less than 3 years. Still can't get no damn job. Trying Best Buy, Verizon. I'm going to put them all on blast, like Walmart. Everywhere, trying to get an entry-level position. I'm like, man, something's up. So I try this little experiment where I'm like, I'm going to use these exact same credentials, but I'm not going to check that damn box. And I did it to several companies in which I would do the exact same resume, change the name. One I checked the box, the other I didn't. Guess which one I got calls back on? Don't check that box. I got several calls, entry-level positions, almost every time. But then I would come in, they would love me when I interview, and I would talk, and I would know about the company, be very interested about what's going on with that job. I'd be like, oh, by the way. And they'd be like, oh, so this here, blah, 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 this in order. I'm like, oh, wait a minute. Oh, there's a mistake. It says the box here. Oh, yeah, I am a convicted felon. Oh, can we talk about that? And then, like, oh, they'd be like, shut down every time. So I'm starting to get frustrated. And honestly, there's times throughout that period, like, I really want to go back to slinging dope. and doing stupid shit because I know it's quick money. I'm good at it. It's a skill. And that's the unfortunate reality, I think, with a lot of people that come home is they go back into those safe patterns. And sometimes that's the only opportunity in some neighborhoods and stuff. You don't have businesses or jobs waiting. So people go back to what they know. It's not right. Most of us know it's not right. But what choice do you have? Thankfully for me, at that time, I didn't have a kid. So it was just, me, I was married at that time, so I had to support my wife, but I struggled. So I'm like, you know what? I'm going to go to grad school. Someone's going to give me a chance in grad school. I applied to different graduate programs, and actually my record barred me from some institutions where they asked about it. And I eventually got to the University of Michigan. They let me in, so I do this master's program there. I get that done in a little less than 2 years. Same thing this time, I can't get work anywhere. Towards the end of that sentence, I got an internship, and the internship was like at a prisoner reentry spot up in Washtenaw County. It was unpaid. And the woman I met there that ran that program, she was awesome. She ended up finding me grant money to pay me to do a program to like engage formerly incarcerated individuals to get out and vote. So she gave me like $600 or $700 as kind of like a stipend for doing some work, but I still couldn't get a part-time or a full-time position anywhere. So now I'm just like, I don't know what the fuck to do. I have no clue what I'm going to do now. I'm years out here. I'm on parole this whole time. I forgot to mention that. So I'm at almost year 6 of my parole conditions. I have an associate, a bachelor's, and a master's from the University of Michigan, and it's not me doing a damn thing for me. It's basically useless pieces of paper. So my only option that I have now is like, okay, I'm going to go get a doctorate. What else can I do? So I'm just juicing that money to survive. I'm pulling out student loans just to survive. And at that time, I was getting scholarship money too, but that's all I had to live off of. So I go out to Western Michigan University. They let me into this PhD program. And the first time, as a part of that application process, I kind of like talked about my story. And I put on paper as part of my application that, what I would like to do with research, I guess, is kind of like stuff that I've been exposed to. Because I feel like I have something valuable, knowledge of not just delinquency, criminality, but the juvenile systems, the prison systems. People can write about this all day, not to fluff myself, but like, I lived it. I could write a textbook on this shit, like, when I'm sleeping. So I'm like, maybe I'll get a job here doing something. Maybe I can do research or work for a government agency or something like that. And I did a guest lecture for one of my faculty advisors' classes, an intro to CJ course. She really loved the lecture and how I was open about my background. And she's like, well, I'm going on sabbatical next semester. Why don't you come teach my class? I'm like, what? I can teach. I ain't got no doctorate or anything. She's like, no. You got a master's. That's the minimum qualification. I go, well, I never taught at the university. She goes, I don't care. Well, I'm a felon. I don't care. Then we go talk to her boss, the department chair. He's like, oh, Aaron's cool. Hire him. I'm like, what? I was just like astounded. I never filled out no box or anything. I didn't need to check the box because everybody already knew. I'm a felon. Shit, the whole department laughs about it. Not like in a bad way, but like, oh, there's Aaron. Yep, he's been locked up forever. You got a question about criminology, go talk to him. So I start teaching the next semester. The problem was I'm doing this PhD in sociology and criminology. I hated it. I really did not like it at all. So any of you that are CJ students, if you've read Marx, Durkheim, or some of the core leaders in sociological thought, I'm like, man, I can't read this shit. This is like old school. Like, I don't know how this is really applicable to my life and the stuff I want to do. So I ended up dropping out of that program. But what is really incredible is that while I dropped out, I finished that first semester of teaching. I got excellent reviews. And my advisor and the department chair is like, you know what? We know you're not happy with this program, but we want to keep you on to teach. So they kept me on to teach part-time. So that became my new job. Like, just kept rehiring me each semester to teach. A few months later, I decided to come back to the University of Michigan. One of my best friends talked me into this education program where he's like, Aaron, I think this would be much more up your alley. because you have a lot of really good ideas of how you can help people coming out of the system and what are things and programs you can create for people who are institutionalized. So I can take my personal experiences and things that I knew that I missed out on or I needed when I was younger and develop curriculum and programs for people coming home. So that was a really great fit for me. I'm glad I did it. I went back there. So I'm doing my doctorate in education now at U of M, banging that out. Towards like my third year of teaching at Western, I'm starting to get burnt out because I live in Dundee, Michigan, which is like 15 minutes south of here. And I'm going from there all the way to Kalamazoo twice a week. And that's a hell of a commute for any of you who know the Highway of Death, I-94, particularly when it's winter weather on the west side. We bitch about this little snowstorm we got here a few inches the other day. They don't get 5 inches of snow in Kalamazoo. They get 5 feet. Okay, and that's no joke. They get hammered on the west end. So I'm driving back and forth sometimes at 4 a.m. That's my work ethic. I'm getting up at 4 or 4:30 a.m. to go teach a class in Kalamazoo by 8 o'clock. Because sometimes them roads are so bad, I've got to be there an hour ahead of time. So I'm hauling ass and getting up there the best I can. At the University of Michigan, again, my work ethic pulled me into a position where I end up getting some recognition for a former faculty member here, Judge Donald Shelton, who was also a Washtenaw County Circuit Judge for, I think, 27 years in Ann Arbor. He also used to teach here at Eastern Michigan University. He ended up getting hired in the University of Michigan Dearborn as the Criminology and Criminal Justice Department Head. We just happened to have a conversation one day, and I was working as a grad assistant on developing an event for him on CJ Symposium. We just started kind of talking, and I mentioned how I used to work at Western. He's like, oh, I went to Western as a young man, blah, blah, blah. Started chit-chatting. And by the end of the conversation, he's like, well, why don't you come teach over here? I'm like, because I have a record, and I don't know when and how U of M's going to hire me. He's like, I'll hire you. Again, big epiphany. Like, whoa, what is... And true to his word, he didn't have anything that summer when we started talking, but that next fall, he hired me on. So I quit my job at Western. I tell everyone there, I love you guys, love KZU, but I cannot drive two and a half, 3 hours sometimes to come out here and make pigeon feed. So U of M doubled my salary and doubled my course load. So actually I'm making like four times what I was making at Western, plus commuting like 35, 40 minutes as opposed to the two and a half hours. Been there ever since. I'm doing great. I'm almost done with this doctorate, and I'm so sick of school now, not to like, you know, dissuade any of you from going on to grad school, but like I've been in this like almost 9+ years now. I'm just burnt out. So I'm fortunate to be at the point where I am now. And again, like where I am now is part ambition, but also kind of dumb luck. Like, so what I want you guys to take away from this is to understand that I did some crazy shit as a kid. A lot of people make a lot of mistakes, but I think for the most part, those mistakes are just, you know, a snapshot in time. They're not really, in, you know, it's not who we are throughout the duration of life. And I think a lot of people, even those that commit violent acts, can redeem themselves. The only violent acts that I have an issue with that I feel is really hard to kind of like come back from is a lot of sexual offenses, particularly child molesters and stuff like that. I'm not saying we shouldn't treat people that have those issues, but I just think it's really hard for someone to have that type of mentality, that type of behavioral act, and come out from that. That's not to say, again, that we shouldn't try to invest in people and try to stop them from acting on these tendencies. But I know people inside that have literally committed murders, and I feel are redeemable, because sometimes, depending on the circumstances, some people are redeemable, and sometimes they made a mistake. Like myself, I could have killed that cop as a young man. I mean, we're talking possibly inches away from me ending his life and then possibly ending mine. And yet, I've come out of that. All my mistakes have been my greatest teachers, and I am where I am today because of all those mistakes. So honestly, like people say, like, well, what would you do if you could go back in time and tell like the younger you? I'd be like, I wouldn't say anything, honestly, because I wouldn't be where I am today if I didn't make those mistakes. I wouldn't have the knowledge that I have today and understand so many different issues and cultural diversity and be able to connect with so many different populations today without those experiences. So all those bad experiences developed me into the man I am today, to where I'm committed to improving my community. I work with juveniles all the time. I work with adults. I go back into the prison systems and work with people and find ways to give them programming so they can come home and not continue to commit crimes. But I also talk to groups to where people are able to give individuals a second chance. Because if we don't change the culture when people come home, if you have just a million roadblocks set up, what's the natural course for someone to do? They're going to break through that wall. And what's coming, you're not going to like, I promise you that. But if we give people a hand up instead of a handout and give them opportunities and prove themselves, that's what's going to make our neighborhoods much safer. So I'll end with that. We still got, I think, plenty of time here. So if anybody has any questions, no question that you're going to ask is going to make me blush, I promise you. So please feel free to ask whatever.
Hey, hi. I was a really good lecture. Not like, really good talk, like, inspired me. I know you really answered that already, but I wanted to ask, really, like, okay, so while you were in prison, like, and you were growing up, like, until the age of 29, did you ever think to yourself, did you ever blame yourself for what happened, or did you blame, like, ever blame yourself for what happened, or did you blame like your upcoming upbringing? And also, do you believe in the concept of free will, or like do you think it's something completely ridiculous? Like, this is like my question is, like, what would you say to your younger self? I mean, I know you said like you wouldn't, you feel like you have no regret, and all this like brought you where you are, but I feel like while you were there, what were you thinking? Like, what were you saying to yourself? Were you like, oh my God, this is like, I'm such a bad human being, or like, I don't know, like, that's pretty much my question.
So, I think I shifted a little bit in the first part of your question. I think initially, when I first came out and even during my prison sentence, I blamed my mother predominantly a lot, and some of the other family members. I put like 100% of that on them. Like, you guys messed me up as a kid. You surrounded me with this. You abused me. You did all these messed up things to me. It's your fault. My thing was, I'm pointing the finger at everybody else. But then as I got a little bit older, probably towards the end of my prison sentence and then out on the streets, I was like, you know, that's only part of the truth. Certainly, my mother and other family members kind of put me on the wrong path, like I was talking about earlier. But yet, I made a conscious decision. I had that free will to reject that. I could have went, you know, to a teacher or someone and said, you know, or child protective services or whatever, like, look, I got to get out of the situation. I don't want to be around it. Or try to go with a family member that wasn't involved in the shit, but I stayed. So I made that conscious choice. Does that answer that? Or?
It answers that, but I mean, I'm a philosophy minor, and I don't really believe in the concept of free will. I believe that there's so many factors that, like, influence people to act. Like, I feel like they're not free from making choices, like, all the time. Like, so that's why I was, like, asking that question.
So I guess I would disagree with that, because I think we do have free will. But certainly, we are heavily impacted by our environment, by other individuals around us. Absolutely. I think it might even be a little bit of a mix, nature versus nurture. Like, our environment certainly, you know, points us down that direction, but also nature, who I am and my being, I still decided. I still made a rational choice at that time. That this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to become involved in criminality. I could have chosen not to. And my example, like, to back that up, is that right now I'm struggling. I am not a baller as a faculty member. Let me explain to you guys right now. So I'm an adjunct faculty member, which means I am not tenure track or tenured. I'm a broke bitch right now, straight up. I have no money. So I could potentially revert back to criminality, because I could go make money. I could go make 50 G's tomorrow. But my free will is that I decide I will not do that because of who I am today, and I make a conscious choice not to do that. So I would argue not.
Could you still, like, keep in contact or see a lot of your family? I recognize that that's your brother, but, like,
yeah.
Aside from his brother.
Yeah. So I have a very difficult relationship with our mother. We have different fathers. But I have a very difficult relationship with my mother, and she still doesn't realize to this day, and she does not, she's not accountable for her behavior and her activities when she was younger.
She thinks it never happened.
Yeah, she taught, like, as a kid, she used to smoke crack with him when I was in prison when he was really young, and his stepfather used to get him high when he was 3 or 4 years old. I wasn't that young when I was doing drugs, but when I was a young teenager, she was smoking crack with me and all this other crazy shit. And putting me in these bad situations as a kid, and she will not hold herself accountable for that. She just, like, plays it off like, oh, I never did that. Oh, everybody else smoked crack, not me. I'm like, Mom, come on. Seriously. I smoked crack with you when I was a teenager, and I know you were smoking crack with my little brother when he was 8 or 9 years old. So it's really hard for me to, I think maybe she feels bad, but she can't verbalize it or say she's sorry. Other, like, stepfathers and other people, I try to stay away from some of them, other family members that are actively involved in criminality or kind of like what I would call on the fence where they're kind of in a gray area where they do some dirt and they come back over flip and do their thing.
And she's still together with the same guy that she's been doing all this stuff
yeah.
throughout the years.
For years and years, right. So I try to stay away from that. Other family members like my grandparents, my grandfather, one, he's a World War II vet. I love him to death. He's like one of the only positive male role models I've ever had in my life. He's 89 years old, widowed. I do my best to take care of him, but he's like an inspiration to me because he's always looked out for me since I was a little kid. But he could only do so much at the same time. So,
you just went into like the first part of the question I wanted to ask. The lack of a male father figure
yeah.
is the first one. Did you ever think of that as an issue, something, not something you just look at because, well, it wasn't there, so I'm going to look past and say it never impacted me because you didn't reference it so
mm-hmm.
much, you went straight to your mom.
Yeah.
So that's the first part. And then secondly, how much do you think race had to do with the treatment that you received, not only on the inside, while you were inside of prison, but then on the outside because of the opportunities you described, some of the social stigmas that
yeah.
are placed because of race and then social dogmas that are out there. So if you can kind of elaborate on those.
So, part one, certainly not knowing my real father, I feel had a strong negative impact upon me and where I had to substitute not having my real father with all these masculine role models who, again, I like I said, were criminals or convicts and or drug addicts. So all my, I guess that was my positive, as close as I had, like the least of those evils, like maybe it was someone just smoking crack that day, not someone pistol whipping or killing people. That was my male role model. So absolutely not having a father in my life who was loving, caring, and showed me right from wrong. Again, I think I felt I knew right from wrong, but still not having a strong male presence that was on the right track absolutely screwed me up. The second part of it, is race a part of it? I think so, to an extent. The interesting thing is most people just see me as like 100% white. I'm not. I'm Hispanic and Native too. And actually, when I was in the prison system, I actually kind of learned deeply about racism because going into the system, most people just think I'm just white. And I associated automatically with Hispanic and Native populations there. So I'm not saying I know what it's like to be a person of color that every day, just at you know face value, that they come across different racism and systemic racism and problems. But I got a taste of it knowing that. So as a perceived white male, young white male coming into the system who shot at a cop, honestly, I didn't have too many problems. But then the funny thing was when I associated with Native and Hispanic populations, I actually felt racism for the first time in my life. And I thought it was just like such bullshit. The guards, not the prison population, but the guards reacted to me in a different way when I identified with people of color. So I had a little taste of it. And working with multiracial populations, particularly from a minority field, is that an issue in our society? Absolutely it is. Did I have a little leg up because I look white? Probably a little bit. But what we need to do as a society is we all gotta get together. I think the problem that we have in society today is that enough white folk are not willing to stand up to fight the problem because they see it that that's not my problem. Okay, when blacks or Hispanics are being discriminated against, they say that's not my problem. or that's like being exaggerated or something like that. So I experienced it to a small degree. I know it's real. And a lot of my close friends who are African American, and I see it in the system, it's all apparent. So what I try to do is I roll with everybody. I don't care what color you are. That's how I see it. But we need to have more people in my position, I would say, just stand up and say that that's wrong, that there are not just individual racist problems that we have, but systemic racism. I think the whole criminal justice system is just full of systemic racism, and just nobody wants to admit it. That's like the elephant in the room. We don't want to talk about that. Yeah, there's racism? Oh, I suppose that was in the 60s. That was way back. Oh, that was in slavery. We don't remember that. But it's real. It's there. Yeah.
You were black.
Oh, man, I don't know. You know, I will say this. I think it would probably be more difficult, but honestly, I think I still would have, because I think a big thing with me was my ambition, my personality, and just outright stubbornness. No matter what I was facing, I kept going. I kept going. Every roadblock, and there's been hundreds of them, I kept going. But I think if I was a young black man, in comparison to now, how people visually perceive me, absolutely would be much more difficult for me to get this position. And it's well known, like Native American, Hispanic, African Americans are very underrepresented in higher education. So that's not something that's just out there. That's a fact. So I think it would probably be more difficult for me, but I think I probably would have still somehow broke into that. Back here and then. So one I mentioned was the Prison Creative Arts Project out of the University of Michigan Ann Arbor. They recruit students to go into youth facilities and also prisons to volunteer and do workshops with incarcerated populations. So that's an opportunity for you, and that's right here in your backyard. Another one that I work with is the Michigan Council on Crime and Delinquency, which is a policy think tank out of Lansing. They do lots of progressive challenges to different legislative bills that impact juvenile justice and criminal justice. American Friends Service Committee, their criminal justice program, which is somewhere here in Ipsy now. Natalie Holbrook runs that. She's awesome. Her and her staff constantly are up in Lansing working on policy reform, and they also go into different state prisons throughout Michigan and work on conditions of confinement. So those would be my top three bigger organizations that I work with.
About prisoner reentry and Catholic Charities in Harvard.
That's no longer going.
Oh, they're not.
And that was a state-sanctioned program that I really, they were doing some good things, but there was a whole bureaucracy around that where it got defunded, and that was a state-sanctioned thing. So I encourage you to go support your local nonprofit, because even the smallest nonprofit in the community that's helping formerly incarcerated populations, again, the impact that that will have, not just on those people, but their children, their family members. I believe incarceration is perpetual. It's cyclical. So like for me, I had stepfathers and other male figures that were in and out of prison. So like that was like natural for me. So a lot of people that become incarcerated, their children have a much higher propensity to end up getting locked up. So we need to break that cycle. And we do that by not just like reforming the whole criminal justice system and breaking the systemic racism that's deep in there. We do that by being proactive and attacking socioeconomic inequality. That's the root of crime. You can't stop all crime by attacking that, but if we all are on a level playing field and we fight civil rights, and I'm going to blast Donald Trump right now on this, like the stupid shit that this man is doing right now, where he is attacking different populations, and he's just basically, I would call him riding a corporate pony. He's pulling in all these people who have multi-million dollar interests and are throwing money at him. He don't give a shit about me, you, or anybody else in this room. I don't care what color you are. He don't give a shit about anybody in this room, because you ain't got no bank. My assumption is we don't have any millionaires in this room. Maybe there is. I don't know. But, you know.
I doubt it.
We got to fight that. And the reason people like Trump and this oppressive regime that he is pulling in here happen, it's everybody in this room's fault. Even if you voted for the old, I didn't even really like Hillary Clinton, to be honest with you. I think she's corrupt. But I'll tell you what, and my boss talked me into this too. Like,
it's one of the lesser
what's,
evils.
Yeah, it's a lesser evil. What's the, you know, it's all a corporate puppet show, but like, Trump is just like, I still like, I cannot believe this man got an off. And it scares me too because of the systemic rate, like, and blatant racism that this man is just spewing and his hatred for women coming out of his mouth. And we're letting that shit go. I just can't believe it. The other part of your question, I think, was like classes I taught. So currently I'm teaching criminal justice systems and policy and correctional systems. Previously, I've taught juvenile delinquency, intro to CJ, criminology, race, crime, and justice, lots of different courses. And I teach in the criminology and criminal justice studies program at U of M Dearborn. So any of you want to go to grad school, do a little plug here, University of Michigan Dearborn, having a Crim and CJ master's program coming up this fall, 2017. Come see me or my boss, Judge Donald Shelton, if you're interested. You guys have a great program here, though, too. Like Paul Layton, who's one of the faculty here, I know him personally. He's a great guy, and I know he works with undergraduate and graduate students in your Crim and CJ programs. So this is a great school, too. I just hope you guys, like, whatever it is you're learning, go out there and be a voice. Don't just sit on your ass and just be like, things will get better. Go out there and make moves. Don't be scared. Just go out there and make moves. Anything you can do, you'd be surprised how just a conversation that you have with someone else in a public place, how that, like, you plant seeds and shit grows and you have no control over how it starts spreading. That's how Trump won the election. He used that same strategy, but in a fucked up way. And now look what happened. We got people like Betsy DeVos who are going to be running the Department of Education now. And this woman is not qualified by any means, but she's got billions and billions of dollars, so that makes her qualified. So that's an unfortunate reality. Any others? Yeah.
Our stories are a little bit similar, actually. And now I work with, like, a lot of people that are, former inmates and a lot of my friends, to be honest, are former convicts and things like that. And one thing that you said really stuck out to me. It was about child molesters and sex mm-hmm. offenders like that. That they're for the most part like irredeemable. And I was just curious because that's one thing I grew up learning too. You know, like getting locked up and mm-hmm. like anyone. And I never went to prison, but anyone that's been to prison, like everyone, fuck those guys. Like yeah. That's it. And I'm just curious if that statement comes more from your prison experience or more from your educational experience or maybe a combination of both.
I would say a combination of both and also my personal life too. So like I recently got a divorce and I have a 5-year-old baby girl who's 5. I love her. She's like the most precious thing in my world. If anybody ever touched her, I might revert back to criminality. So I understand and as a young man, I was never sexually abused, I was physically abused, but I had cousins and other people that I was around, particularly young women, that were sexually abused. And I saw the impact as a child, so my personal life was touched by that before I even got locked up. But then certainly when I get into the system, I see how people are treated from that. And I think kind of rightly so. I think karma, I don't believe in God, but I have some different religious things that I pull from here and there. I think karma's a bitch sometimes. And people that do stuff like that, I don't know. Is it possible they can be redeemable? Maybe. I think we need to be more harsh on people that are violent sexual predators that rape women and children. That's my personal thing. We need to be. You want to be tough on crime? Be tough on that shit. If someone is going to go out and hurt someone physically or take something so precious like that from them, let's be harsh on that. Let's be real punitive on that. Let's not worry about the dude that's got a couple ounces of marijuana, okay? Or a guy that might even have an ounce of methamphetamine or cocaine or whatever, and let's not give them life in prison. I'm not saying that that's the best thing to go out and sling crack, meth, whatever, but like I think our priorities are shifted and all screwed up in the system. We'll throw money, billions and billions of dollars, to go take drugs off the street when in reality we're taking less than 1% of those drugs, and you can't stop people from being drug addicts. So that's like simple economics. You can't, you know, supply and demand is always going to be there. You can't change that. Okay, but what we can change is we can be more harsh on people that are committing violent offenses. Even someone like myself, you need to be harsh on me. If I go back in time, if I was a journalist, like, done. That's unacceptable behavior. We need to focus more on people that we're not mad at. So we focus now on people we're mad at, not that we're afraid of. And we need to reverse that. So that would be my perspective on that. But certainly we need to, like, give these guys treatment, because some of these people we're just letting out. They might rape 3 kids. We let them out. Oh, put them on a sex offender registry. That makes everything better. Bullshit. They ain't doing nothing. If they're that much of a threat to society, we shouldn't have let them out to begin with. That's just how I feel. I just feel our priorities, it's all monetized. And we don't focus on what's important. This is my, I go off on tangents sometimes. War on drugs. I'll be here all day talking.
I want to know about how drug abuse and or drug recovery has impacted your situation. Like, did you have access to treatment while you were incarcerated, or like just being out of that environment?
Yeah.
Was that like a byproduct of it?
So, luckily for me, I was only abusing drugs heavily for maybe 4 years straight. So my early teenage years up until 18, I didn't get too, I think I have a very addictive personality, but I feel that like drugs just happened to be my choice at that time. So I think like over the years, I still have an addictive personality. I'm not getting fucked up anymore, but like there are certain things that I still shouldn't be doing. Anyway, there was very little drug treatment programs inside. Programmings in a correctional facility are few and far between. And I honestly just quit cold turkey. Like when I first, I'm not gonna lie to you guys, when I got in the county jail, I was stealing pills off a cart, getting high off opiates. Not even gonna lie. Smoking marijuana in there, snorting pills. I went to the state prison. I had an epiphany. I'm like, I'm gonna be here for 19 years. I am not gonna continue this downward spiral. So I just quit. I didn't do any drugs while I was at. I got drunk once. Homebrew, if any of you heard about that or see that on MSNBC Raw. It's a real deal. I got so fucked up, it ain't even funny. But, like, the headache, and I never get hangovers, and I can drink. This was just like, ugh, I've had my experience with homebrew. It was cool. No more. But I kind of just gave that up, and I feel that was more, maybe I really wasn't an addict to begin with, honestly. Or maybe just drugs wasn't the thing that I needed to fulfill myself. Do we need those programs inside? Absolutely. And even more inside, we need them as part of post-incarceration programming. Because people that come home, you can get all kinds of drugs on the inside. Like, I had people that were just doing dope on the regular. You can get heroin, crack cocaine, pills, whatever you want inside. But nobody talks about that because the administration is like, oh, well, these horrible inmates are stealing and getting drugs from their visitors. Yeah, that's true sometimes, but a lot of the dope that's coming into facilities is from administrative staff. Mm-hmm. They're smuggling drugs in, and nobody wants to recognize that. So coming home, people need substance abusers. People that have really strong substance issues, they need an opportunity to break that cycle. And if we don't give them that help, what are they going to do? They're going to go back to doing dope. And then what do you do if you don't have money for dope? You're going to go rob somebody. You're going to go pistol whip somebody. You're going to shoot somebody until it just keeps escalating. So... that's a big problem.
You said you were from Dundee, right?
Yeah, hillbilly capital, Michigan. I am one of the few hillbillies, though, that you will meet who is not a racist piece of shit. So
I was from Britain, so it was like...
that's hillbilly-ish.
Yeah. Gotcha. So I was kind of shocked, though, that all that happened right there. Like, it's such a small town, and I grew up...
oh, no, that incident didn't happen there.
Okay.
That was out of state.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah. No, it didn't happen in Dundee, but this was back in 97 that this all went down. So it happened in Maine when I was an 18-year-old kid. I live there now. I came back home to Dundee, and I just got a nice little house and go up to Cabela's now and then and buy stuff I shouldn't. Can't have guns, though. No guns. I want to have that.
Did you have trouble with parole since you're not supposed to leave the state in which the incident... is that true that you're not supposed to leave the state in which the incident is in when you're on parole? Did you have trouble moving from state to state?
Well, so when I was in the state of Maine, I had to get something called an interstate compact, which is a very complicated legal agreement that allows me to leave the state I was incarcerated in and come back to another state, and you have to have a justification for that. For me, I grew up in Michigan. I had good family here. and also had been accepted to a college. So they accepted, they really fought me on it, but all the legal things I did against them, they didn't want to keep that fight up going. Because I would, like, anytime I would have a problem with the administration at that point in my life, towards the end, I would just sue them. I'm like, you guys, you got beef? You want beef? I'll go to court. We'll deal with it right now. So
you appealed this decision and moved from Maine to Michigan while you were still in the system?
Yes. Like my last year and a half, I put in the request and they granted it. I was really, I had to fight for it for a while. But in the end, I think they realized they would rather have me out of the state and not deal with me anymore. Just let me go home. So I was really fortunate to have it. They could have kept me there. And honestly, I think if I would have got released in the state of Maine where I was incarcerated, I wouldn't be talking to you right now. My ass would be locked up finishing up the rest of my other half of my 19-year bid. Something would have happened where they would have trumped me up. Or maybe I would have done something stupid. Got myself locked up, but combination of that. That's
random question. Why'd you get pulled over, and what happened? Did your girlfriend get any charges or anything at the time?
To this day, I'm not sure why I got pulled over. In the incident report, they said, the state trooper that pulled me over said he had a hinky feeling, whatever the hell that means. H-I-N-K-E-Y, hinky. So he pulled us over, and then, like I said, that was my reaction to that. You know, I felt trapped. What was the second part?
Did your girlfriend that?
They did charge her, dismissed it. She gave statements to three different officers at that time that I did not, like, have an intent to kill anybody or anything, blah, blah, blah. Later on, she retracted that statement when the DA was ready for trial and pushed on her that they were going to try to charge her as a conspirator. And she testified against me. So initially she was not charged. They let her go. And I even was very verbal. Normally, just FYI, you get, you know, detained, arrested by the police, invoke your, you know, Fifth Amendment rights. Don't, just shut the fuck up. Don't say anything. Be quiet. I was like spilling my guts because I didn't want anything to happen to her. So I was like, I did all this. I didn't say I want to kill anybody. But I was just like, yeah, I shot the gun, I did this, blah, blah, blah. I just spilled my guts, let it all out, because I didn't even care at that point. So, yeah, she did all right. But she had to try to get me in the end. They were going to get me anyway, though, honestly. I don't even really have any anger towards her, because she was put in a situation where they scared her.
She's just a kid.
The submission, yeah. So.
Okay, so, were you drunk that night? I mean, I don't know if it was night, but when you pulled.
That's a funny story.
Because that's why, my belief that free will doesn't exist, I can go on about it, and I have so many factors that can explain why I don't believe free will exists. It's not only because I think, I know you said that you did drugs and whatnot,
yeah.
And also that influenced you to think all this impacted you in, coming to this action. But there's also people who have, mental health disorder. They don't have,
the cognitive ability to understand right from wrong, absolutely.
I mean, not everybody has that cognitive ability. That's one. Second, also it's everybody's brain don't function the same. We have no control over what's going on in our brain. So that's that's one of the reasons why I believe free will exists. And that's why I'm thinking were you on drugs or were you sober? What happened? That was your reaction. And
yeah.
You think you could have made a better choice. But I just don't. I don't know.
Okay, so I'm not going to argue the free will thing again because we'll go on about that all day. I lied to the police and said I was under the influence of narcotics, thinking that that would help me, honestly, to think that I was in some type of a dazed, drug-induced state to where that would help me. The honest-to-God truth is, right here, right now, I was not under the influence of any drug. I was coming down from some drugs, weeks before. I was, not withdrawing, I was on heroin or anything like that, but I was, definitely... probably not in the best state of my mind as a kid, but I don't think that affected my decision at all. I was just a combination of a couple things. One, I was an asshole kid that had no regard for authority whatsoever. I was aggressive. I was violent. My whole life pathway was when I feel threatened, I act out immediately to protect myself. So that was an instinctual action, I feel. And again, I will hit a brief, I feel I had that free will, I made that choice. Even though it was a split second decision for me to pull that gun, I made that choice. I did it. And no drug previously or trauma or any of that stuff. It certainly may have like led me down that pathway, like I said before, but again, I made that decision. So. Anything else?
Career-wise, what's next for you?
Career-wise?
The perplexities of someone in your circumstance with having to check that box, but also knowing that you're using what they tell you as education to drive you to the next level, but understanding the limitations and being realistic.
Yeah,
about the
sure.
That you are.
So, I've been teaching now for almost 5 years as an adjunct. I have really good reviews. I've made some connections with some really good people in academia. Again, like I said, with my boss and other people. I recently went to the American Society of Criminology and was connecting with other leaders in the field, some of whom have similar circumstances as me. They're called kind of criminologists, where other people like me, I'm not the only one. There's at least a dozen or a couple dozen faculty members nationwide, particularly that come to this ASC meeting, that are formerly incarcerated. And they use that incarcerated lens to dictate their research agenda, which is exactly what I'm doing. So I'm just kind of stealing that model. I'm like, hey, well, that's a good idea. Let's put it over here. And I'm using that. Hopefully, once I'm done here within the next year, I want to get a tenure track position. I want to get that bank. I want to be able to do the same thing I'm doing now to teach and give service to my university by all these programs and stuff that I'm assisting with. But I want to get paid. And I think, honestly, I have a really good opportunity to make that happen. And it's not what I know, even though my background and experience is I think, is powerful. But it's not, that ain't what's going to get me the job. It's knowing people. Everybody in this room, it is not what you know that's going to get you employed. Let me be very clear. And that doesn't mean if you got a record or not. It's who you know. That's what's the most important. So I encourage all of you, you need to make strong relationships with people who have power and influence and connections. I'm not saying use folk, but like you need to make, you know, these connections, because that's what's gonna, like for me, I've already got some faculty members that are telling me this time next year, come on, bro, let's come my way, and they want to hire me. That's how you really get jobs. And for me, honestly, that's the only way I would ever get employed, because without that face-to-face and those connections, I'm screwed. Because it took me 6 years to find a job then, and I don't want to go do that again. I don't want to sit on the market for 6 years and try to get a full-time faculty slot. And I do consulting on the side, too. That's my other thing. That's my other hustle, entrepreneurship, which I think for anybody that's formerly incarcerated is the key, vocational and entrepreneurship opportunities. People that used to hustle dope like me as kids, they are the best business men and women that you will ever meet in your life. And I will put my life on that. Because they may have only had $10 or $15 one night, but they find a way to flip that money into $150 to $1,500. They'll hustle. They'll go see Billy. They'll go see Paul. Jamie. Boom, 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 boom. End of the night, $2,000. That's a legitimate skill set that you can take into the legitimate marketplace. It's just we have to have to remove the stigma with incarceration to understand that people can do the right thing with that bad skill set. Someone else? Yeah, back here. Yeah.
You referenced check the box several times.
Yep.
I'm just wondering, has there been some legislation or something? Do you still, you know, hey, somebody has a felony on the record, do they still need to check the box? Or any thoughts?
At the state level, yes. There are some municipalities and cities that have banned the box, meaning that they no longer ask that question. But ban the box just means that they don't ask about your felony convictions at an initial application. Once you get brought in for an interview, they'll still do a background check on you. So all that really is, so many people don't really understand what ban the box is. Ban the box is just basically giving people who are formerly incarcerated a fair chance at having a conversation. Because someone like myself, like I said, hundreds and hundreds of applications out there, nobody wants to talk to me because I'm a convict. But when I take that little box away, and my go-getter attitude, and my credentials, and my work ethic, when people have a face-to-face conversation, that changes the whole paradigm. That's what we need, I think, at the state level, to give people that opportunity, just to have that face-to-face. You don't have to, it's not saying, you have to hire felons.
Right.
You have to do it right now. That's not what it's about.
Give them a chance.
A couple years ago at the state legislature, I supported a bill that we were trying to get that statewide so that this would not be on anything in the state of Michigan, but it got shot down. Nobody was interested in pursuing it because of that thing where there was this miscommunication and people were like pushing it to like, you know, oh, it's the employer's right to choose. Well, it's fine. You can still do a background check on folks and you can still make that decision whether or not you hire someone, but just give people a chance to come talk to you. That's all the bill was really about. But nobody wants to hear that shit. So, yeah. Will something happen? I don't know. Not with our current legislature, honestly, not anytime soon. Not with the federal government that is led by Chancellor or whatever the worst Roman ruler was. Trump, I don't know. Yeah.
You know, you mentioned making friends and connections with people, and it sounds like you've really kind of done that. Like, have you thought about trying to work through maybe those people to apply for, like, clemency from the state of Maine, for, like, the governor or anything like that?
Yeah, it would never happen. I thought about it,
Yeah. Honestly.
And the irony is, and I'll tell you a little quick story, the associate director of corrections who's out there now in Maine, another thing, because of my go-getter attitude, I'm working with the former director of the Michigan Department of Corrections, who's retired now. She brings me out to Colorado to work with the Bureau of Prisons, Department of Justice. I do consulting to train wardens, regional directors, county sheriffs. Run my mouth for a little bit, get paid $2,000. They introduced me to the associate director of the Maine Department of Corrections, who was not there when I was there. She was in the juvenile division. But that was a really interesting opportunity for me to like have a conversation with her. I don't know how other things could really change with other than getting face to face time. What was the other part?
Well, just I know someone that did that in Michigan.
Yeah.
You know, he worked in corrections and everything, and he had felonies, and you know,
How did he get into corrections?
He started.
Also, the expungement thing, yeah. So, like, yeah. That,
well, not expungement. He got clemency from the governor.
Gotcha.
After the fact. But he started working in halfway houses and worked his way in through there. But his pathway was he just ended up over the years making enough connections and knew someone that was on the governor's staff and just had put it right on Granholm's desk and she signed it.
She cleared it out, right? So that's where I was going with that tangent. So that associate director of the Department of Corrections said she would support me for something like that.
Mm-hmm.
However, I know, and I don't even want to waste my time because the governor of Maine right now, Paul Page, extremely conservative, extremely
mess. That's the thing, you gotta,
mess.
Might have to wait till
if there ever was a more progressive governor, and I don't know if I could have it, and he wants to commit political suicide, he or she wants to commit political suicide, because like what I did, I think, is rather severe, and it was against law enforcement. So honestly, I don't think it ever would come to fruition. Even if I had like the whole that stack in my favor, you're still going to have a political figure that would be, in my view, like that would be political suicide. Because they're going to say, we're going to support someone to try to kill a cop.
Yeah.
No matter what I did. It don't matter if I saved 20 babies in a fire. I'd be like, dude still tried to kill a cop when he was a kid. So he went against the government. So I don't think that they would ever support it. All right. We're all going to go out, do some work, change the world.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks for coming out.
Thanks everyone for coming out. Thanks Aaron for coming out as well.
Yeah, no problem.
If anyone is interested, we actually got you this mug too.
So all right.
Put it in the near U of M
office. Cool.
But questions about the Criminal Justice Club or has any leftover questions, I'm sure we'll be hanging around for a few
minutes.
Yeah,
I'll hang out for a bit.
There's flyers in the back about how to find us. We have a Facebook page. It's Criminal Justice Club at Eastern Michigan University. It's very creative, but yeah, so we're easy to find. We're on OrgSync on those flyers in the back. Next week, at the same time in the same room, we're having a special agent from the ATF come out. He'll be talking about, that's the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, so they kind of do they regulate firearms, and if someone blows up or burns down like a Little Caesars or something, they go in and investigate it. So if you're interested in like the special agent position or the forensic side of things, I would suggest coming out and seeing what he has to say. So Thank you everyone for coming out. If you have any questions, just feel free to
One other quick plug. If anybody's on Facebook, I've got a we have a criminology student group as well. It's called U of M, Criminology and Criminal Justice Collective. And I mentioned to Sam, we have a lot of, and I mentioned all of you too, we have a lot of these field trips to different correctional facilities. I'm happy to extend that invitation to anybody in the room. If we go to the Jackson Prison or a county jail or anything like that, I'll coordinate with Sam, anybody that's interested, and check that out on there. You'll see on that Facebook page when we have different opportunities to go in the community. So.
All right, thanks for coming.